So now this is for GC. Well, liquid chromatography is much more, it's much simpler in operation. It's just liquid, there is no problem of in the class. When you talked about gas chromatography, one of the things is if you want to inject a gas sample, gas has to be converted to vapor in that injector, and the injector has to accommodate the phase transfer and all that, so you have some limitations there. Where your sample has to be extracted using a compound solvent that will vaporize in the injector to become and go along with the gas. Liquid chromatography, that problem doesn't exist. So especially LC is used for samples where you do not want to do extraction and all that, and for various reasons. One is the compound will get denatured or something, will get spoiled, will react. Second is concentration is very low, so you don't really want to do this. Third is some compound you cannot analyze using GC-MS. GC-MS is, if you have it, it's preferred because it will remove a lot of uncertainty straight away. But if you don't have GC-MS, people use FID with a lot of quality control verification and all that. Well, liquid chromatography is used in some cases. You see a lot of standard methods, many of them don't use liquid chromatography. They are all GC-based methods because it's, the range of GC is much higher. But for some compounds, LC is used, but you can use it. So what I am telling you is, you can use liquid chromatography if the compound can be analyzed using that. So same system, but it's a packed column. No capillary columns in liquid chromatography, and the same things apply here. The mobile phase is a solvent. It can be a single solvent or a mixture of solvents. Okay, so this packed column, you can change the temperature, but you can't change it in the range of a GC. Temperature control is usually not. The reason we don't do it is there is a liquid inside, and if one of the liquids, if you increase temperature too much, it will start boiling and it will vaporize, and that will create a bubble, and that bubble stuck in the column is a problem. Flow will not occur properly. So you want flow to occur properly because you are basing everything on retention time, and retention time changes because of flow non-uniformities which will occur because of bubbles. We don't want all that. So temperature people don't usually play around with in liquid chromatography. So temperature is there usually to maintain constant temperature, that's all. The oven is there as a controller, because ambient temperatures may change widely, and therefore partition constant will change with that. So, but in order to prevent that, they have a constant temperature compartment, but it's usually around ambient, 25 to 40 degrees. That's the range in which they are maintaining it. But what you can change is the solvent. Carrier gas, like carrier gas you can't change in gas chromatography, but here you can change the solvent because you are pumping it, you have freedom to change the solvent. So you can mix mixture of solvent. So where in the GC you can do temperature programming, here I can do solvent composition. I can change the solvent, I can start solvent composition at 1, and then I can go, I can increase it dynamically. This is possible. Solvent composition is, for example, if I have two solvent, a mixture of two, so I have solvent A, let us say I have water plus acetonitrile. I can start, this is percentage of, this is percentage of acetonitrile. I can start at a very low percentage of acetonitrile, and I can increase the percentage of acetonitrile, and then I can keep it high. So this, by doing this, I can change the polarity of the mobile phase, and therefore the partition constant will change. This is possible to do. Typically this, because you are sending a fluid, flow rates are very small, there is also a packed column, pressure drops are very high in the system, pressure is very high. We don't operate at very high flows because of that, pressure is very high. There is a detector here. Liquid chromatography is straightforward because everything goes through into the column. There is nothing, no vaporization, no possible losses, nothing. So it's fairly straightforward. So the detectors, what kind of detectors? So because it's a liquid, you have to use something that will, that can analyze liquid. Okay. So the common detectors used in liquid chromatography are UV visible spectroscopy. Refractive index, then is fluorescence, yeah. So this is normally called as UV-Vis, this is RI, fluorescence spectroscopy. UV-Vis and fluorescence spectroscopy are, to some extent, they have some limited capabilities of identifying the compound, okay. The basis is again, just like we have mass spectra, you also have UV visible absorption, absorbance spectra. So absorbance, these are all, this is based on absorbance, okay. Okay. So the UV absorbance I'm going to the next slide. So UV absorbance like this. So absorbance, this is a specific compound. Now absorbance, the UV spectroscopy as a word suggests, this is your sample. There is light at some wavelength. There is a light source, there is a radiation source. Spectroscopy is this. This is a general basis of spectroscopy, and you're sending it at some intensity I0. If there is a molecule inside here, which will absorb some fraction of the radiation, okay, and therefore what is transmitted will be less that fraction, okay, and there is a detector here. So based on this, is minus log I by I0 is the absorbance. Basically, you calculate what is the amount absorbed by what, this is what is transmitted and what is incident, okay. And this A, the absorbance, is a function of the concentration or amount of, you have high concentration of a particular compound, it means that there are large number of molecules in this fixed volume, and therefore there is large amount of absorption. So if you calibrate, the absorption will be a function of the concentration. Higher the number of, higher the concentration, higher will be the absorption. This is absorbance, not absorption, absorbance. This is molecular spectroscopy, UV absorbance, there is no fragmentation or anything. It, the entire molecule absorbs some, it, if you go deep into it, some sections of the molecule is actually absorbing more than the others, all that is there, but we are not looking at that. So if you look at the absorbance spectra, this is the absorbance spectra, you can see some spectrum like this, which means that it is absorbing at certain wavelengths, it is absorbing more. So this is a UV absorbance spectrum. So there are lambda, this is lambda in nanometers, this is a wavelength. So at one particular composition, one particular concentration, this molecule will show this up. It will show the same spectrum if the concentration is smaller or higher. So there is a point where it can go all the way here, you can't do anything. All right, I will stop here, we will continue tomorrow morning, we will try to finish up this and talk about other methods of analysis of the air and metals, and then we have one more small topic after that.